Ladies and gentlemen, this is now our fourth week teaching from the book of Romans, chapter 8. I said to you in the beginning how powerful this book is and that Christian victory lies within these 39 verses. 4 weeks ago, I told you that I was going to begin a series entitled R8W. Amen. I made wristbands. Who has not received their wristband yet? Put your hands up, and John will give you a wristband so you can be part of the group here. Amen. We came up with a Romans 8 creed. Michael, can you find that Romans 8 creed for me? And I'm going to have you actually stand to your feet if you can. And we're going to declare this creed as warriors and not wimps. Amen. We're going to declare this with our mouth and with our hearts. And get excited about what the Holy Spirit is going to do in this place. Amen? Are you with me? How many warriors do I have in the house? Now, like anything in the Word of God, the devil knows the Word. The devil knows Romans 8. He knows every verse. He's memorized the Word, knows the Word intellectually better than you do. And the enemy knows that when you know the Word of God by revelation, then you're dangerous to him. It takes no big skill to read this Word. It takes no big skill to memorize this. It takes no great skill to write it down. And it takes no great worry to say amen after every verse. But if you want this to work in your life, this Word has to become alive. And for the Word to become alive, you've got to be alive. Amen. Amen. So let's repeat this Romans 8 creed. In the name of Jesus, amen. Say, I am a Romans 8 warrior. I walk by the Spirit and not by the flesh. Therefore, say therefore again. Therefore. In other words, the conclusion of what I just said means this. There is no condemnation. I am a child of God. He is my Abba, Father, and all things work together for good. If God be for me, who can be against me? Neither death nor life will ever separate me from the love of God. Put your hands to heaven and say that one more time, because I'll tell you something. This that last declaration is one of most significance forever. So neither death nor life will ever separate me from the love of God. And all of God's warriors said,
amen.
Hallelujah. Amen. You may be seated. Hallelujah. Number one, we learned in Romans chapter 8 that there is no condemnation. Number one, we learned in Romans chapter 8, you don't have to walk around anymore in a state of condemnation. The law can no longer accuse you.
Amen.
That's a big thing. In other words, we're not serving God for fear of penalty. We're serving God because we love Him. Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.
Number two. Because we do not walk in the spirit of condemnation, something most powerful is declared. We now inherit the spirit of sonship. Sonship. We are His sons and His daughters, not just His children. When children are born, they become parents' child, but it doesn't make them their sons or daughters. Just because you're born with the name of your mother and father doesn't make you a daughter and doesn't make you a son. It is but by the Holy Spirit that we can cry out, Abba, Papa. Now, apart from the Holy Spirit, we always approach God in a state of guilt and fear without the Spirit. And instead of crying out, Abba, Papa, we cry out, Oh, Heavenly Father. We are going to read verses 1 together. We are actually going to read verses 1 right to where I will begin my continue my teaching. Amen?
Amen.
So, let's look at Romans 8, chapter 1, and Michael, we're going to go through verse by verse until I tell you to stop. Amen? All right, are you ready? You got your Bibles out. If you don't, take a look at the screen, and everybody out loud, read these verses with me. Say, there is therefore, come on. Now, no condemnation to them which are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. For the law of the Spirit in Christ Jesus has made me free from the law of sin and death. For what the law could not do, in that it was weak through the flesh, God sending his only Son in the likeness of sinful flesh, condemn sin in the flesh, that the righteousness of the law may be fulfilled in us who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. Let me just say this to you and stop you for just a moment. The law cannot be fulfilled by keeping the law. Walking by the Spirit fulfills the law. Did you hear me?
Yes.
Keeping the Ten Commandments, every dot and tittle will never fulfill the law because there's always a little carnality in there. How then can we fulfill? By walking in the Spirit. And thus we fulfill the law. Do you got that? I just had to throw that in. Verse 5, for they that are after the flesh, come on, do mind the things of the flesh, but they that are after the Spirit, the things of the Spirit. Verse 6, for to be carnally minded is death, but to be spiritually minded is life and peace. Verse 7, because the carnal mind is enmity against God, for it is not subject to the law of God. Neither indeed can be, verse 8. So then, they that are in the flesh cannot please God, verse 9. But you are not in the flesh, but in the Spirit, if so be that the Spirit of God dwells in you. Now if any man has not the Spirit of Christ, he is none of his. Verse 10. And if Christ be in you, the body is dead because of sin, but the Spirit is life because of righteousness. Verse 11, but if the Spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his Spirit that dwells in you. Hallelujah. Verse 12, therefore, brethren, we are debtors not to the flesh, to live after the flesh. Verse 13, for if we live after the flesh, we shall die. But if through the Spirit do mortality the deeds of the body, we shall live. Verse 14, for as many as are led by the Spirit of God, they are the sons of God. Verse 15, for we have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but we have received the spirit of adoption, whereby we cry, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself, verse 16, bears witness with our spirits that we are the children of God. Verse 17, and if children, then heirs and heirs of God and joint heirs with Christ. If so be that we suffer with him, that we may also be glorified together. Sonship, church. Sonship is the seal of adoption. Verse 18, for I reckon that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory of God which shall be revealed in us. Amen. Verse 19, for the earnest expectations of the creature waited for the manifestations of the Son of God. Verse 20, for the creature was made subject to vanity, not willingly, but by reason of him who has subjected the same in hope. Because the creature itself also delivereth from the bondage of corruption into the glorious liberty of the children of God. Verse 22. For we know that the whole creation groaneth and travaileth in pain together until now. Verse 23. And not only they, but ourselves also, which have the first fruits of the Spirit, even we ourselves groan within ourselves, waiting for the adoption, to wit, the redemption of our body. Verse 24, for we are saved by hope, but hope that is seen is not hope. For what man seeth, why does he hope for? Verse 25, but if we hope for that we see not, then do we with patience wait for it. Verse 26, come on. Likewise, the Spirit also helps in our infirmities, for we know not what we should pray for as we ought, but the Spirit itself makes intercession for us with groanings which cannot be uttered. Hallelujah. 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 Now, just by you reading that out loud as you did, the Bible promises that my word shall not return void. And just by you reading those 27 verses of filet mignon, church has fed your soul. And now this is the revelation that the Holy Spirit gave me. In addition, church, to number one, realizing as a child of God, we no longer have to walk in fear. And finally, now the condemnation is over. Number two, we learn that because we are in the Spirit, we are now sons of God, whereby we cry, Abba, Papa. Number three, we also learn that we are temples of the Holy Spirit, whereby which the Holy Spirit prays through us. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We learn something most glorious in these following verses. And you may want to write this down. Say this after me. Say, my salvation started in eternity past. Say, my salvation started in eternity past. Number four, give me your eyes. Look at me. We're about to read the most glorious verses that somehow just shook me so much. Did you know that it took eternity to save your soul? Did you know that from the beginning of time, before you walked on this earth, before that, from the beginning of time, God has been working to save your soul? Amen. And we're going to show you this in Scripture. And Paul, as beautifully as he does, describes it in verse by verse. I was in prayer this morning before I came, and I was laying on my bed, and I was so enamored with the concept that before my name was Michael, before I was born to this world through my mother, before that, God had a plan for me. Look at verse 28. And would you please again read it out loud? Come on, come on. And we know that all things work together for good to them that love God, to them who are the... To them that are the... Are you the called?
Yes.
Say, I am the called. And because you are the called, it says all things work together for good to them that are the according to his purpose. Now listen up. It is the Holy Spirit within you that gives you the strength to hope in the midst of suffering. It is the Holy Spirit that gives you that revelation that in the midst of trials and challenges in life, it is the Holy Spirit that is working in you. How do we know that He is working in you? How do you know that? How do you know that God is working in you? Well, guess what? Your mind will never know that. Your mind is like... It's like the seasons, they come and they go. One month you love God, one month you read the Word, one month you tell Him you love Him, one month you tell Him you hate Him, one day you love people, one day you hate people. That's the mind. But the Bible tells us that when we know the Holy Spirit, church, the Holy Spirit says, God is working all things in your life for good for those who are called for one divine purpose. The Holy Spirit gives us the confidence that we are the called. Listen to me. People ask me all the time, why did that have to happen? Car accident the next, why do little babies die? Why, oh why, oh why? But let me just tell you something. This word tells us that all things work together, come on, for good to them that... Stop! To them that love God, to them that are the...
Called.
To them that are the...
Called.
According to...
His purpose.
Whose purpose?
His purpose.
God has a purpose for everything. Now, we in the mind... Hello, are you looking at me? In the mind, we question God. In the mind, we... God, why did you allow this? In the mind... We get angry at God. In the mind, we get bitter at God. In the mind, we can't understand God. But in the Spirit, Paul tells us, but in the Spirit, no more is it why. It's all according to His purpose. Who does that? Who gives you that revelation? The mind? The Holy Ghost. How many of you people have gone through some really rough tragedies or going through them at the moment, and for just a moment you thought about it and you got angry and you got bitter and you got mad, but then all of a sudden that inner voice comes inside of you and sweeps out all of that negativity? Because... He says it's because we know the Holy Spirit, because we are the called, we know we are called according to?
His
purpose. Can I hear a big fat amen?
Amen.
Before we knew the Holy Spirit, we always asked why? The other day I had lunch with a pastor. Having a great time, a great conversation. And he said, tell me what it was like when you first met the Holy Spirit. I said, it was the most glorious moment of my life. I can remember it vividly this day. And I said, let me tell you what happened to me when I met the Holy Spirit. I said, before I met the Holy Spirit, I had a hard time with spiritual things. I had a hard time and I questioned God at every turn. But when I met the Holy Spirit, I made this declaration to heaven and I said, Lord, no longer will I question your word. Lord, no longer will I question you. No longer will I doubt you. I will take your word literally, every dot and every tittle, and Holy Spirit, strengthen me so that I can stand on the word of God. It's the Holy Spirit that does that, folks. Amen. Now, I'm not saying to you, I'm not suggesting to you that for a moment you may question, you may be angry with God. You may question His purpose in life. I'm not saying that that won't happen, but unbelievers that don't know the Holy Spirit live their entire life being bitter at God. But not you. Because we know that all things, come on, we know that all things work together for them that love God, to them who are the called. Folks, do you know that you're called?
Yes.
Did you know that you're all ministers in here? I just have a different job than you. I'm the one with the big mouth, amen? God gave me a big mouth. You may not have a big mouth like me, but you have a gift. And you are ministers of the gospel called according to His purpose. And when you know that deep inside your soul, when you is absolute assurance inside of you that God has called you for one divine purpose, the why questions, the blaming God, the shaking the fist at Him, that is the gift of the Holy Spirit. Can somebody say amen?
Amen.
Verse 29. For whom He did foreknow. Wow. Whom He did foreknow. I was foreknown by Him. Listen, he also did predestinate to be, come on, conformed to the... Whoa. That he might be the firstborn among many brethren. Now, wait a minute. God's eternal purpose is to conform you. Are you awake? God's eternal purpose is not that you build a fancy big house and drive a fancy Cadillac. God's eternal purpose is not that you raise three children and have a successful job. God's eternal purpose, come on, is that you conform. Come on. Is that you conform. So what are you wasting all your time for on Cadillacs and big fancy houses? Did you know that before the foundation of the earth, God had a plan that you would be conformed like his son? Because he knows one day you're going to go to glory. He knows one day everybody in this room is going to shed this bodysuit. Amen? Everybody know that? And when you shed this bodysuit, he's going to look at you and he's either going to see Jesus in you or not. So, he foreknew. And he also predestinated. You had no choice in it. Big shots. To be, come on, conformed. That he may be the firstborn among his brethren. Hallelujah. So look at me. God's eternal purpose in your lives. Are you awake and listening to me? Get your eyeballs up here. God's eternal purpose in your life is not big fancy Cadillacs and big fancy mortgages on your house, blah, 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 blah. His greatest objective in your life has been before you were born out of your mama's womb is to transform you. Transform you. To change you into the image of his son.
Amen.
Now let me ask you a question. Do people see Jesus in you? Hello? Now the room got real quiet there for a little while there. Do you ever hear people say to you, boy, since you got saved, you're a different person. What has happened to you? Something's happened to you. That's his job. That's the transforming power of the Holy Spirit. Before eternity, that was his job. Look at 1 John chapter 3. 1 John chapter 3. Come on, beloved. Now are we the sons of God? Come on. And it does not yet appear what we shall be. But we know that when we shall appear, we shall be like him, for we shall see him as he is.
Amen.
Can Christ be seen in you? Who did that? The Holy Spirit did that. You didn't do nothing. You didn't do a thing. Matter of fact, it was up to you. You'd screw it all up. Are you learning something? Let's thank the Holy Spirit right now. Let's just thank him right now. In spite of how rotten you can be sometimes, in spite of that, thank you, Holy Spirit. Thank you for working in me. Hallelujah. The Holy Spirit is working in us. Look at me. The Holy Spirit is working in me. Thank you, Jesus, that the image of Jesus may be seen in me. And verse 30 of Romans 8. Moreover, whom he did predestinate, that's you. He also called, that's you. And whom he called, that's me and you. He also
justified.
And whom he justified, he also glorified.
Amen.
Notice something. Past tense. Past tense. He justified, he glorified in you on this earth while you live, that you would be conformed to his image. He justified you. He predestined you. You are now glorified with him in heavenly places. Amen. Lord, don't I just have to say one more Our Father? No. Because you know the Holy Spirit, ladies and gentlemen, he said, you are justified. You are glorified. Now wait. Look at me. God calls. God calls. Say God.
God
calls.
Calls.
Look at me. But not everybody answers the call. I was having lunch with this pastor the other day, same one I was telling you about a moment ago. He's a little bit older than me, maybe 5 years older than me. He's like 35 or something like that. Ish, you know. He says, have you noticed how many men and women that we started off in ministry with 30 years ago? Look at me. They are no longer walking with the Lord. I said, yes. Many are called. Many are called. Few answer. Few are chosen. Do you want to be one of the chosen?
Yes.
Respond when the phone rings.
Amen.
He predestinated the called. He justified the called. He glorified the called. So when he calls, answer the phone.
Amen.
Hello, I said, when he calls, answer the phone.
Amen.
Now, look up here. We've talked about being delivered from the spirit of condemnation. In other words, we're serving Christ, amen? Not because we're in fear of punishment, amen? We're no longer condemned because we know the Holy Spirit. Now we're serving him because we love him. And the Bible tells us that the law can never fulfill the law, but the Spirit fulfills the law. So now we no longer walk in fear of God. We walk by the Spirit and not by the flesh. The Word tells us that because of the Holy Spirit, we know that we are sons of the living God. The Word also tells us not only do we know we're sons of the living God, but in verse number 26 and 27, it says we are the temples of the Holy Spirit who prays for us, not with us, for us. Wow. And then it says from the beginning of time, he predestined that we would be conformed to the image of his Son. From the beginning of time, you had nothing to do with it. It was just answering the call. What a great Jesus we serve. Aren't you folks glad you know the Holy Spirit? Aren't you glad? Aren't you enjoying this chapter? On this wristband that you're wearing, it has the name of the church. And right there to remind you that you are an R8 warrior, you are a Romans 8 warrior, not because you have big muscles and a big mouth. Amen? Look what the Holy Spirit has done in your life. Amen. Look at verse 31 of Romans 8. Now this is powerful. Oh boy, oh boy, oh boy. Oh dear. Okay, now that you know all these things, there is no condemnation. Amen? You are a son and daughter of God, right? Now that you know that you are a prayer temple inhabited by God Himself, you are a child of God. He says, what shall we say to these things? If God be for us, who can be against us? What things? We are His sons and daughters. We are led by the Spirit and not by the flesh. We fulfill the law by not keeping the law. We fulfill the law by walking in the Spirit of Christ. What shall we say, born again believers, to these things Pastor Mike has expounded on? If God be for us, in these last 30 verses, who in the world could ever hurt us? Are you getting this? I'm so excited, I'm sweating up here. Whose hand can stop the transformation of you into the likeness of Jesus? Tell me who. No one. No devil from hell can stop the transformation of the Spirit of God working in you. But if God be for you. Now we got to read something else here. It's going to throw me over the edge, so get ready. I don't want anyone in this room to ever fear death. But you have every right in the world to fear death if you are not conforming to the image of His Son. People that fear death because they don't have the transforming power of the Spirit working in their life, and they're scared to death to die. Oh death, where is thy sting? There is no sting in death. Tell me, if God be for us, can death separate us from the love of God? Can peril, can sword, adversity? Now look at me. This one you need to write down. Although salvation from your point of view appears to be instantaneous, from God's standpoint, salvation has stretched from eternity past for you. And the only time, listen to me, the only time your transformation is complete is when you die and stand before Him. You either stand before our Heavenly Father completed in Christ or incomplete. Thank you, Holy Spirit. even when I am a crumb, even when I am bad, even when I don't say things right, even when I don't deserve it, I don't need to deserve it, for therefore there is now no condemnation for those that are in Christ Jesus, who walk not after the flesh, but after the Spirit. If God be for me, who can be against me? Look at me, look at me, look at me. Not even you can be against you. Amen. Look at me. It took eternity to save your souls. Hello? In the eyes of God, it has taken eternity to save your souls. Our salvation began in eternity past. Not the day you walked in this church. Verse 32, and we're almost ready to wrap it up. Amen? I think I've given you enough to eat today. Amen? Come on, verse 32. He that spared, come on, not his own son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him also freely give us all things? Verse 33. Oh, we got to park here for 30 seconds. Look at me. Who can lay a charge against his chosen? Look at me. If somebody says to you, I've seen the bad things that you've done before. I've seen you sin. I've seen you treat people disrespectfully and wrong. Weren't you the guy that used to drink all the time? Weren't you the drug addict? Weren't you the adulterer? Who can lay these charges against God's elect? For it is only God who justifies, not man. He justifies, he glorifies, he sanctifies. Who can lay a charge? Not even your own mama. Verse 34. Who is he that condemns? Is it Christ? Yea, rather, that is risen again. Who is even at the right hand of God? Who makes what? Wait a minute, wait a minute, wait a minute. He makes intercession for you. Are you awake?
Amen.
While you're sleeping, while you're having a beer, while you're doing things you shouldn't be doing, while you're saying things, thinking things which aren't right, it is Jesus who sits at the right hand of God, forever, continually, around the clock, praying for you that you conform to his image. Who can lay a charge on God's elect? If God be for you, how do we know these things? But by the Spirit of God. How do you know this? How do you know this? In your mind? By the Spirit of God. Folks, look at this. He makes intercession for us. Wow. Oh, it's so powerful. Look at me and get this deep in your hearts. Amen. Anyone who tries to stop God's purpose in your life will fail. They may try to discourage. They may try to come down on you. They may try to hurt you, but nobody can come against his elect. His purpose lives on forever and ever and ever. Amen. Next verse. Oh, dear Jesus. Who shall separate us from the love of Christ? Come on. Who shall separate me from the love of Christ? And he lists some things. Look at me. He lists some things that have the potential of doing so. Will tribulation separate you?
No.
It tries and tries. How about distress? Oh, it works very hard, doesn't it? Persecution? Hard. Famine? Nakedness? Peril? Sword? Verse 36. As it is written, for thy sake we are killed all the day long. We are counted as sheep for the slaughter. Verse 37. Nay, in all these things, come on, in all these things, we are more than conquerors through him that loved us. I got to say this again. This is not a head thing. You're not going to leave here and go, ooh, if God be for me, who can be against me? This is a faith thing. Although at every turn I face with trials and challenges and difficulties, distress and tribulation, the Holy Spirit says, I know you face all these things, but if God be in you, who can be against you? That's a faith thing. Verse 38. Oh boy, I love this. Come on, read it out loud. For I am... Wait a minute. For I am persuaded that neither... Next verse. Oh, nor depth, nor any creature shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is Christ Jesus, our Lord. Hallelujah. Close your Bibles and stand to your feet. Hallelujah.